I'm Alex Moe in College Park, and coming up on Maryland Newsline, I'll tell you how the Attorney General's Office has issued an opinion that will affect the entire University of Maryland system.
I'm Megan Pratt, and a canceled hearing in Annapolis yesterday is causing some controversy for state officials. That story and more, Maryland Newsline starts now.
This is the side.
I want camera two to go back to the two shots.
Take Francie G.
You're camera one.
Take camera three, Mike.
I will get your script back to you in rapid fashion.
Three, two, one.
Taking aim at sexual assault, the Attorney General's Office weighs in, and we have the exclusive story. Good evening and welcome to Maryland Newsline. I'm Yanae Givens.
And I'm Pete Muntean. Today marks the start of Sexual Assault Awareness Month, and on the campus of the University of Maryland, students took part in a project to share their voices and speak out against their own battles with abuse. But while the project was out in the open, the university says those files on those cases should be closed. Maryland Newsline reporter Alex Moe talked with politicians who say that's not the case. Alex?
Thanks, Pete. The university has kept issues of sexual assault fairly quiet over the years, but in doing so, they may have been violating the law. I have the exclusive on students who are stuck in the shadows at the university, but thanks to a new opinion from the Maryland Attorney General's Office, that may be changing.
Before this, like, I had no idea. Like, you never think it's going to happen to you, and then when it does, you're kind of like,
Rose is among many who took part in today's clothesline project in College Park to raise awareness about sexual assault. She is far from alone.
One in five women will be the victim of rape or an attempted rape just while they're in college. So the prevalence of sexual violence on college campuses runs about 20%.
Student victims of sexual assault at the University of Maryland have only a few options when it comes to reporting rape. They can do nothing, report it to police, or seek an administrative hearing. Proceedings before the university's Office of Student Conduct are not open to the public, and neither are their results. The university claims it can't release that information because of the Family Educational Rights and Privacy Act, or FERPA. But Montgomery County Delegate Bill Braunrot recently asked the Maryland Attorney General's Office to review that policy.
I'm a strong believer in open access and in the process of the Public Information Act of the Maryland. And I thought it was important that we know exactly what the letter of the law is.
The Attorney General's Office responded, and in the written opinion that it returned, said that, quote, if the university finds that its rules or policies were violated in a matter involving or concerning a forcible sexual offense, incest, or statutory rape, the final results of the disciplinary proceeding, including the identity of the accused student, may be disclosed without violating FERPA. Accordingly, the student's identity would be available in response to a PIA request.
Lots of schools misinterpret FERPA and say that anything and everything connected with the disciplinary process, even the end result of those hearings, is confidential educational information. You now have a ruling from the Maryland Attorney General that sets that straight.
We filed a formal request with the university asking for all records of students who have been found to violate the Code of Student Conduct for sexual assault in the past 10 years. We've asked university officials for their opinion, but no one has agreed to talk. Sexual assault advocates say the release of the identities of offenders is important to public safety and in the public's best interest.
Most men never rape anybody. But the ones who do tend to do it over and over again. And that is where we need to be focusing.
I can't change what happened to me, but maybe I can help change what happened to somebody else.
So will the university change its policy in light of the Attorney General's stance on releasing offenders' names to the public?
Well, we still don't know. I filed our public information request on Tuesday and still haven't heard anything back.
Alex, do students think they have enough resources at the university for dealing with sexual assault?
Well, there is the SARP office, which is located in the University Health Center, and there they help with counseling and bringing awareness to some of the issues. So there are resources available.
Great story, Alex. Thanks. Tuesday's drive-by shooting that killed four and injured five has D.C. police trying to prevent further retaliation. Police officials say they are gathering intelligence to see if there are any beefs between two groups. The gunfire was aimed at a group of mourners who had just attended a funeral for a man killed over a piece of missing jewelry the week before. So far, three have been charged with the first-degree murder, including 20-year-old Orlando Carter, who is also facing charges for the original slaying. and the rape and murder of a 65-year-old teacher in February at a detention center facility in Prince George's County raised many questions, and that will call for a public hearing. Some lawmakers wanted to find out what went wrong, but as Maryland Newsline's Megan Pratz found out, you may be able to call for a hearing, but that doesn't mean anyone will show up.
It's a crime that shocked many. The murder of a teacher at Cheltenham Youth Facility in Prince George's County. And lawmakers in Annapolis called for a hearing.
To have a public discussion and answer some troubling questions.
But the hearing was not to be. The lawmakers who called for it were left standing in an empty hearing room in Annapolis.
There was a coordinated effort that we've become aware of behind the scenes to shut that down.
O'Donnell points a finger at legislative leaders. A statement from the Department of Juvenile Services says the Secretary of Juvenile Services was advised by Senate President Mike Miller and Speaker of the House Mike Bush that this hearing was not called by a legislative body and should not appear. But there are differing opinions.
This hearing was shut down. It was shut down hard. And people were doing it to protect political careers.
Just want to have some answers, just a few answers, not just about Cheltenham. I think that it was a conflict of messages.
So they plan to reschedule and hope the secretary is able to attend this time around to provide the answers they're looking for. I'm Megan Pratz, Maryland Newsline.
Police did question a 13-year-old resident about the murder, although no charges have yet been filed. Two workers at the Cheltenham facility were dismissed following an investigation into the murder of 65-year-old Hannah Wheeling.
Prince George's County voters have another option in the race for county executive. County Sheriff Michael A. Jackson is the latest to join in the race that has at least five other candidates. Jackson kicked off his campaign Wednesday. He says his background in law and order gives him a leg up on crime issues. Jackson was sheriff in 2008 when deputies mistakenly raided the home of Berwyn Heights Mayor Shai Calvo and killed his dogs. Baltimore City Council President Jack Young doesn't live in the row house that's listed as his official residence, but he does live in a row house around the corner from it. Young says he lists the other home as his official address because it was his first house and it makes him feel more secure. He took reporters on a tour of his second house and even showed them his underwear. Living in the city is a requirement to be president of the council.
Maryland has a strong farming heritage, and as some license plates read, our farms are future, but maybe not for much longer. The farmer has fallen on hard times. State and national leaders met with Maryland farmers today at a roundtable discussion in Upper Marlboro. Congressman Steny Hoyer and Agricultural Secretary Tom Vilsack took questions, and farmers voiced concerns about increased red tape from environmental regulations and estate tax hikes. All this on top of a harsh winter and a late start to spring. For many farmers, it hasn't been easy.
Most of these folks and the families that they represent not only have to work the full-time operation on the farm, but they have to have themselves or a spouse or a family member working off the farm.
This type of a format is very positive for Maryland farmers and farming as a whole.
Two generations ago, 15% of Americans were farmers. Today, that's down to only 1%.
Coming up on Maryland Newsline, it's no joke, it's Census Day. But one big city in our region isn't filling out their forms at a good rate.
And there's more to this truck than meets the eye. We'll show you how it's keeping our soldiers safe. Stay with us.
In 1977, an 8-year-old boy picked up the game of golf from his father. The odds of that same boy then making it to the US and European pro golf tours? 1 in 7 million. The odds of the Big Easy winning the U.S. Open twice, 1 in 1.2 billion. The odds of him having a child diagnosed with autism, 1 in 150. Ernie Else encourages you to learn the signs at autismspeaks.org.
G-morning, sunshine. Wakey, wakey. Text me.
I think it might be 1 in the morning.
Are your parents home later? We can hang. LUV, love you. JK. Holla back. Holla back. Holla back.
Are you with your friends? That's lame.
We're in a huge fight right now.
XO.
What'd you dream about?
Something I did.
Are you on your way to the mall?
Lonely.
Nude pics. Send me some. Text me.
Hey.
Ready to go?
Yeah, but the fire's not out.
Close enough.
Huh. Close enough? If it's too hot to touch, it's too hot to leave. I mean, the next thing you know, you've torched our whole neighborhood.
Which is why we're not going anywhere?
Exactly.
9 out of 10 wildfires are caused by humans.
Only you can prevent wildfires.
Filled out your census form yet? Many in Baltimore haven't. The city has the lowest response rate in Maryland. So far, less than half of Baltimore's households have mailed back census forms. Mayor Stephanie Rawlings-Blake says that at this point, Baltimore is comparable with cities like Washington. In the 2000 census, Baltimore was the second lowest in responding among cities with similar populations. Today is National Census Day, and Maryland Newsline's Chinna Mae Wilson was at a rally in D.C. where officials pulled out the stops to make certain everyone steps up to be counted.
It's April Fool's Day, but census officials are not fooling around. It's Census Day, and they want you to know success is in our hands.
I think it's really important to fill out your census to preserve your family heritage.
We said that it's 10 questions and it's 10 minutes. A lot of my friends are calling me and said, you lied, you lied, you lied. It only took me 3 minutes to fill out.
D.C. Delegate Eleanor Holmes Norton is putting out a challenge for residents of Washington.
We will be initiating a contest on my website by neighborhood to see who gets there first, who gets there second, and who doesn't get there. If you don't get there, we're coming out there to find you.
Census officials are hoping that leaders of different ethnic communities will get their members to participate in the census.
We're talking about resources. We're talking about political representation. We're talking about health care. We're talking about education. We're talking about things that are vital to the Latino community.
But is the message getting across?
We are very proud that so many Vietnamese have already filled out the census report 2010.
So, does it really only take 10 minutes to fill out?
No, a lot less than that. Only takes a few minutes.
Census Director Robert Groves says the Bureau will continue to accept mail forms for the next 2 weeks. After that, they'll come knocking on your door. In Washington, D.C., Chinna Mae Wilson, Maryland Newsline.
It's estimated the Census Bureau spends $1.5 billion to collect forms that are not mailed back on time.
You may have thought swine flu was no longer an issue, but the state had its 45th death from the illness last week. Before then, there hadn't been a swine flu death in Maryland since February, and the health department wants to keep the illness at bay. There are more than 150 swine flu vaccination clinics offering to give the shot for free. The Centers for Disease Control and Prevention says the southeastern states are now seeing a resurgence of the flu. And security is getting beefed up at the metro station at the Pentagon following last month's deadly shooting. The Pentagon Force Protection Agency had added more random inspections of employees, extra screenings of visitors, and better communication at the agency's command center. The agency says the Pentagon is still a target and must adapt to evolving threats. Security at the Pentagon is undergoing a multi-million-dollar, 5-year overhaul.
Decision-making can be hard, especially in the Marines. Maryland Newsline's Akeem R. Henry was at the Pentagon today, where the Rapid Reaction Technology Office showed off the latest addition, which they say will make military decisions easier.
For Marines moving around in dangerous places like Afghanistan, you can never be too careful.
The ability to pass targets and to cooperatively engage or make decisions to engage, make good decisions about, you know, when or how or if to apply lethal force, I think is what makes this unique.
This is an improved vehicle to more safely move troops and supplies. Each wheel on this truck is almost half my height and as wide as my leg. And the colonel says they are good for navigating Afghanistan's rough terrain.
The colonel says that this vehicle is very popular for troops in Afghanistan.
But it's what's on top and around the truck that will give the military an advantage. They call it the Gunslinger Package for Advanced Convoy Security, or GunPACS.
Acoustic gunshot detection, it's got decision-making tools, and it's got a remote weapon system that are integrated into a user-friendly interface to enable good decision-making by both the driver, the vehicle crew, and the unit commanders.
So why the gun packs on these trucks?
Because there's so many of them, and the Marines who are going to Afghanistan, we're looking for a way to enhance the combat capability so that you don't just have a truck moving from point A to point B. You now got a weapon system.
And with the weapon system on board, you can better defend yourself when you come under attack.
I have four of them, but that will be sufficient to develop a concept of operations or a concept of employment of how best to utilize this or how to maximize the military utility of this capability.
And to all enemy combatants, beware. At the Pentagon, Akeem R. Henry, Maryland Newsline.
Those gun packs will accompany the U.S. Marine Corps and their 7-ton trucks for deployment to Afghanistan with the 1st Marine Division this coming September.
Coming up, the zoo got a new octopus, but one of the zoo's biggest attractions may be next to add a new family member.
And kids from all over the state finish a competition to be number one. We'll have their story coming up.
My name's Brandon. In 9 years, I'll be an alcoholic.
Hi, Brandon.
I'll start drinking with the older kids. And whatever they do, I'll do.
Kids who drink before age 15 are 5 times more likely to have alcohol problems when they're adults. So start talking before they start drinking.
I know we'll start with alcohol. I'm just not sure how it's gonna end.
Rob, what's up?
How's it going?
Guys, this is my cousin Rob from Michigan.
What's up?
He's a teenager.
Hey, what's up? All right. Oh, hey, you wanna slow down?
No.
Really? Huh. Hey, you know what a beautiful animal is? A horse. A horse. Yeah. Beautiful mane. Unbelievable muscle tone. When it runs, it looks like poetry in motion. It's the most beautiful thing on earth. And sometimes when you feed a horse, its lips will tickle your hand. Just tickle it just a little bit. It makes me giggle sometimes. I don't know. I guess what I'm trying to say is, if you don't slow down, I'm going to bite into your head like an apple. And thanks, guys, for listening to my horse stories. I could talk about ponies all day long.
Students from across the state were honored today for learning more than their history books tell them. A competition earlier this month tested middle and high schoolers on their knowledge of the African American experience as a part of history. Maryland Newsline's Tahir Lindsay tells us more.
Our champions.
And today, with proud parents, teachers, and principals looking on, students from across the state were made to feel like winners, because they are. I was excited to learn a new, different part of history, but it was also nerve-wracking because, you know, African Americans aren't put as the center focus for American history. These contestants studied lots of trivia, facts, and historical references all related to the African American experience. And according to the leaders of the Black Saga competition, it's that experience, not the awards, that will set these students apart. Governor O'Malley took part in honoring the young winners and said that African American history is everyone's history.
I think there is no story that is more important to that than the story of the African American experience, the Black Saga. And I think it's important for not only black students, but it's equally important for white students, Asian students, Latino students. It's important for all of us.
Make no mistake, these accomplishments were achieved outside the classroom. Students had to bone up on their own time. But students like Kira Steyer says, it was all worth it.
It was pretty fun. I'm on a team with my friends, so we would go over to each other's houses and study. And it's pretty fun after school and stuff, so yeah, it's just kind of fun.
I would say there is no most important fact or most important person. All of them like contributed to what we have today. Without them, if we lost one of them, it would not be the same United States of America that we have today.
In Annapolis, I'm Tahir Lindsay for Maryland Newsline.
This year marks the 13th year of the Black Saga Awards. Next year, more schools from across the state are expected to participate.
Knows the good weather lately? Michelle Obama has, and she's taking advantage of it by getting out and gardening. The First Lady hosted local elementary school students this week who helped her plant vegetables in her White House garden today. Obama says it's also fun digging around in the dirt, and she planted a couple rows of broccoli and rhubarb herself. And it's Panda Watch 2010, and it's underway at the National Zoo. Zoo officials say rising hormone levels in their female giant panda, Mei Xiang, could mean she's pregnant. If Mei Xiang is pregnant, she could give birth in less than 2 months, but officials are cautious it may be a false pregnancy. Mei Xiang gave birth to Tai Shan in 2005. He was sent to China earlier this year.
That's Maryland Newsline for tonight. Thanks for joining us. I'm Pete Muntean.
I'm Unae Givens. Happy April Fool's Day. We'll see you back here tomorrow. Bye.